So hi everyone, and today's topic is about tuberculosis lymphadenitis. Okay, as we know, tuberculosis, okay, it is a chronic specific infection which is caused by Mycobacterium tuberculosis. Okay, TB is a multi-systemic infection wherein it can be divided into categories like chest and extrapulmonary tuberculosis. Okay, chest means the chest tuberculosis always consists of pulmonary, pleural, mediastinal nodes and pericardium. Okay, so this is called as the chest tuberculosis. What do you mean by extrapulmonary tuberculosis? Recently, the classification of extrapulmonary tuberculosis has gone beyond the limit. For example, the most commonly in extrapulmonary thing which we can see manifestation will be at TB neck nodes. Okay, it can also be called as tuberculosis lymphadenitis. Okay, the second is going to be an abdominal tuberculosis. Third can be a genital urinary tuberculosis, skin and soft tissue tuberculosis, bones and joint tuberculosis, CNS tuberculosis like tuberculosis meningitis. Okay, and there are a lot of irrespective of the conditions, there are a lot of classifications going on beyond the limit for the extrapulmonary tuberculosis. So the recent things are also called as ocular tuberculosis. Okay, there is an mass like ear tuberculosis. So therefore, the patient has got lots and lots of new varieties of tuberculosis in an extrapulmonary case. In that, recently we can start seeing about the extrapulmonary. Before that, we can see here a chest radiograph which shows miliary tuberculosis, that is a significant tuberculosis X-ray. Okay, and then we can also go ahead with the surgeon's point of view or the surgeon's role. What are you going to do in a pulmonary tuberculosis? What are you going to do in an extrapulmonary tuberculosis? So usually in pulmonary tuberculosis, the patient can go for a permanent lung damage. And if you're going to treat him, okay, the picture can also go beyond a multi-drug resistant. And therefore, there's a focus on the pulmonary tuberculosis activity located in a particular segment, lobe, or a zone, or in a lung. Okay. So therefore, the important surgeon's role will be a surgical excision. That is the recent advances that we have got. And next is the pleural effusion, okay, which occurs in the later stages wherein ICD can also be used. Okay. The third point is going to be a completely fibrous lung. In that case, what are you going to do? Nothing but we're going to do a pneumonectomy. So that is going to be the last treatment of choice that we are going to have in our mind. So therefore, now we are going to start going to the extrapulmonary tuberculosis. Here we can see the patient is having a bone and joint as well as cutaneous. This is a cholesterol abscess. This is a gibbous formation, which is because of the TB spine. Here we can see the genital urinary tuberculosis. So the most commonly now we are going to enter is the TB neck nodes, that is also called as a TB cervical lymphadenitis. Okay, it is the first and most commonly manifesting feature of extrapulmonary tuberculosis. Okay, so therefore it is more common in Indian subcontinent. Okay, because TB is endemic in our area rather than the other countries. Okay, usually in TB there's a clinical feature patient giving off is nothing but the patient will be having a matted lymph node mass, which is a typical clinical feature for a TB cervical lymphadenitis. So any of the cervical group of the lymph nodes, for example, gigulodigastric, submandibular, supraclavicular, and the posterior triangle nodes can also be involved in that. What are the clinical features that you see in typical cervical lymphadenitis? It will be almost equal to a permanent tuberculosis, where the clinical features can be evening pyrexia, cough, malaise, failure to thrive, and it is most, which is going to be a most common significant finding in a children. Okay, so next is going to be what happens in neck. Okay, usually we can expect a cholesterol abscess. Okay, in the collar region, where usually when we put a shirt here, this is a collar. So this is the collar. So this comes around the neck, and then this area is also called as a collar area. So the collar area has a stud abscess, like a stud. It just stands, and then it gets projected out of the skin of the particular region. Okay. So see here, we can see that the cervical lymph node has got ruptured, and then therefore the patient has gotten ulcer in that particular area. Okay. So therefore, here you can also see a TB node in the deep extension. See, here we can see a TB node. Can you see it here? Can you see it here? Yeah. So there is an extension into the deeper structures also. So what is tuberculous lymphadenitis? Okay. Tuberculous lymphadenitis is the most common form of extra permanent tuberculosis, and it is most commonly caused by Mycobacterium tuberculosis and not by Mycobacterium bovis. Okay. What are the sites where we can expect this tuberculous lymphadenitis? The most common is the neck lymph nodes, as well as the next common will be upper deep cervical lymph node, which is also known as jugulodigastric, which is nothing but like it is also a in an, it is also seen in the cervical region. Okay, it is a 54%. Okay, the next common is the posterior triangle lymph nodes, which is 22%. Okay, so the disease can also occur in other lymph nodes like axillary lymph nodes, para-aortic, mesenteric lymph nodes, and inguinal lymph nodes. Therefore, it is a generalized condition. Wherever it wants, it can occur. But the most commonly seen is the neck nodes, which is also called as a cholestatic abscess. Okay. The patient can also be associated with HIV infection and lymphomas. So therefore, the patient is in immunosuppressive state. Therefore, TB comes into a role when the patient is in immunosuppressive state, and also in immunosuppressive state with the HIV infection. Okay. So the rarely spread can occur from the tuberculous region of the apex of the lung through the suprapleural Simpson's fascia or the membrane to the supraclavicular nodes. Okay. So the often fibrosis and calcification will be occurring in these nodes with or without the treatment given to the particular patient. Therefore, you can expect an abscess to be present in the collar region, where it can rupture and become an ulcer, or else it can go for a fibrosis, as well as it can also go for an calcification. Okay, first of all, if I tell you that the patient's cholestatic abscess has gone to a rupture as it has gone to calcification, so you have to start thinking about what should be the stages of the tuberculous lymphadenitis, right? The first is a particular nodes get infected in a primary tuberculosis. Okay. After some time, when the node has been affected for a very long time, it leads to a lymphadenitis. Okay. Then what happens? There is a staging of periadenitis with mating. Mating means there is a 2 to 3 multiple cluster node infected node together. Okay. The third stage is nothing but stage of caseating necrosis and cold abscess formation. So now they have all got mated together. Now it has made a very big circle where it can start their process of caseating necrosis and the cold abscess formation. Okay. The fourth stage is the most important prominent stage you can start appreciating, is the cholestatic abscess. Okay. If the cholestatic abscess, you have seen that it's a cholestatic abscess, the patient can have a differential diagnosis of tuberculous lymphadenitis, which is most commonly seen in India. So once you have diagnosed it, then therefore immediately start the treatment as soon as possible. If you are not going to do a treatment, what is going to be the next stage? That is a stage of formation of sinuses, which starts discharging yellowish caseating material. So therefore, we have 5 stages, okay, which will be leading to the next if the patient is not properly diagnosed and managed. And therefore, the last stage is a very problematic, because the sinus formation and then there is a rupture of the sinus. Therefore, there is an open ulcer in the collar area, which is not going to be the easy part for the surgeon, because the treatment through internally will be with the help of an ATT, that is antitubercular drugs. The other treatment is going to be the healing of the ulcer in the particular neck region, which is going to be a tedious process for us. Okay. So what do you expect in the gross pathology? Okay. You have taken a cross section or a cut section of that particular lymph node. What will you be expecting in that gross pathology? I can see a firm, okay, mater. Mater means 2 to 3 nodes circling together. Okay, so we can see a firm matered lymph node with cut section showing yellowish caseating material. So that is how we can see in the gross pathology. Okay, now what is going to be the microscopic finding? If I keep that particular pus discharge And if I'm going to keep the lymph node dissected region under the microscope, I can start seeing the epithelioid cells with the caseating material, which is seen along with the Langerhans type of a giant. Excuse me, Langerhans type of a giant cells. Okay, so now we have seen what is the gross pathology, and gross pathology is directly we're going to see, and then we're going to appreciate what is happening on the front. Microscopy is always under a slide. Under a microscopy with a slide, we're going to see what is going to happen. Okay. Okay. So now, as we know, tuberculosis means what? The patient has a loss of appetite. The patient has a loss of weight. And then the patient has a fever. The patient has a intermittent cough with sputum expectoration. That is a normal thing which we know about a permatuberculosis. So what happens in an extra permatuberculosis mainly in the neck nodes? Okay. Initially, the patient has a swelling in the collar region, which can be a firm and matted. Okay. If the patient has gone to a stage of cold abscess, it could be soft, smooth. Initially, patient gives a history of non-tender abscess present in the neck. Usually, if I get an abscess, I have a cut injury in my hand and then it has got infected and then it has gone to a formation of an abscess. Okay, in that condition, I can always tell I will have a tenderness always possible in that particular region, right? But what happens in the collar or the cold abscess, we can always appreciate that. The patient also tells a history. It is not painful for me at all till now. So only after you have seen it, I have also seen it only after the projection. I have seen it accidentally and not because of pain. So always keep in mind the cold abscess is soft, smooth, non-tender, it is fluctuant because of the abscess content without the involvement of the skin. Okay, and we should also know that it is not having any warmth on palpation. Okay, there is no warmth differentiated for this particular cold abscess. As a result of increased pressure, sometimes what happens, this cold abscess starts rupturing out the deeper fascia. Okay, so now it is enclosed very tightly inside the deep fascia. It is very tight, the cold abscess. What happens because of no treatment and no kind of an early diagnosis, the patient goes for a rupturing of that particular cold abscess into the deep fascia, which forms a collar stud abscess, and it is also adherent to the overlying skin. Okay, so we always think of a collar stud abscess, we can tell like it is a projectable one over the skin. Okay, so it is projected one. So what happens when the collar stud abscess is a projected one? It often gets injured with the patient's hand or with the clots, and therefore into a rupture or a burst open condition. And therefore, patient has a discharging sinus formation, which is the fifth stage we have seen previously, and that occurs in the patient. Okay. Usually, I'm telling it is a multiple one because there is a mating, that is not a single one. There is a multiple involvement, which is wide open, and it is also often undermined. Also, we have to think of the type of the ulcer. It is an undermined ulcer. And after the undermining, we can also see a non-mobile with bluish color around the edges. Okay. And we can also say it is a non-indurated one. Okay, and if at all, it is an external thing. Once I see the oral cavity, sometimes the tonsils will be studded with tubercles. And so clinically should also be examined for the, what are you going to see? Okay, fine, we can see tonsil now. We can tell the patient to open his mouth or her mouth, and we can see the tonsil in the tonsillar fossa, right? So we are going to see in the tonsillar fossa, and then we have to see there is any collection in the crypts of the tonsil. Okay, if that is the case, then what it should be going for, then we have to start evaluating that tonsil. So this goes to a different scenario of an ENT opinion, where the patient is taken to an ENT surgeon, he starts evaluating and he comes to the conclusion. So meanwhile, during this, the patient should also be tested for a permanent tuberculosis. So a TBCD opinion has to be taken, and we have to take the patient for chest x-ray, where we can confirm with the chest x-ray, right? And the other tests like Montux can be done. So these are the conditions, and this is the multidisciplinary action or the treatment that we are going to take for this patient. The next is going to be an ortho thing, because in ortho the patient has to be taken for a review of the cervical spine examination for tuberculosis, because bone and joint is the next important tuberculosis effect, except from tuberculosis effect, okay, on the body. So now, what could be a differential diagnosis for the cervical neck, neck collar, stud abscess, whatever you say? So initially, I can say it is a non-specific lymphadenitis, okay? I cannot immediately tell it is tuberculosis unless it's an endemic area. Second can be the patient can have lymphoma and then chronic lymphatic leukemia, okay? These are the two conditions, which is the, like, patient should be having a lymphoma or CLL, okay? So these people will also have a mimicking kind of a collared abscess, but we can't tell it's a collared abscess, okay? Second is in the neck because of metastatic actions. The fourth thing will be branchial cyst mimicking like a cold abscess. Branchial cyst is a congenital one. So we have to start asking the history of whether it was come recently or it has been present for a long time from childhood. Okay. And then the next evaluation should be either it is a lymphatic cyst or the lymph cyst mimicking a cold abscess. Okay. The lymph cyst can also occur in conditions like any early breast carcinoma or DCIS, ductal carcinoma in situ, can also be a reason for a lymphatic cyst on the particular neck region. Okay, the next category is going to be the immunocompromised category, where the patient is having HIV infection with lymph node involvement. Okay, the last category where we can see is in immunocompromised, usually patient goes for a fungal infection. As we know, the tuberculosis starts attracting an actinomycosis. Recently, I have come across a case where a patient has an osteomyelitis of the mandible. Okay, so in that, the patient most probably can have two differential diagnoses. As we know, we can think about tuberculosis as well as an actinomycosis, because the tuberculosis has the effect or it has the attraction towards the actinomycosis. So therefore, we can start thinking about the actinomycosis when there is a discharging sinus. Okay, so let's go to an important question to you in your final years. Okay, so what is the question? The question is, what is a cold abscess? Define cold abscess. What happens is, this cold abscess is nothing but there is a mating, okay, the mating, and there is an abscess formation which is always present deeper to the deeper fascia. Okay, when it is present deep behind, okay, or below the deeper fascia, we can always not have any evidence or signs of inflammation, and the patient or the person whom you're going, whom I'm going to examine as a doctor and as a patient, we both cannot be expecting a warmthness. We cannot expecting any tenderness on that particular swelling, and it is usually very soft and smooth, and it will be a fluctuant one, and it will be always a not trans-eliminating one, okay? So the most important thing, the doctor cannot appreciate the abscess, okay, as well as the patient cannot also appreciate it, because it is present deeper to the deeper fascia, okay? And the next thing is, can I pinch the skin over the swelling? Yes, it is possible, because it is not adherent to the skin. The skin is always free on the upper portion, okay? Because it is always present below the deeper fascia. Always remember, we are deep inside the fascia. So therefore, the skin can be pinchable on the superficial area. So this is superficial. The deep is inside, okay? So in the deeper region, we can always not appreciate for fixativity to the skin, okay? Therefore, the skin is always free on the outer area, okay? Since we can't expect the evident signs of inflammation, we should also have in mind what are signs of inflammation that we are going to see. What we have studied in pathology is Ruber, Kahler, Dohler, and functional dysthea. So Ruber, Kahler, Dohler means there is no redness present in this particular thing. Do you agree? Yeah, because of the deeper presentation out of the deeper fascia. Okay. Next is, okay, for example, this cold abscess, if you're going to cut deep open, what will you get inside the abscess? We can always see a cheesy caseating material, which is diagnostic of a tuberculosis. Okay, this tuberculosis thing, no, it is most commonly seen in caseating tuberculous lymphadenitis because of the caseating necrosis. Okay. So what happens is cold abscess only when it gets ruptured because of the excess content or the too much infection present inside the abscess cavity. It gets ruptured up and then it forms a callosity abscess, which is happening above the deeper fascia. Therefore, it comes to superficial fascia and now it starts showing us the color of it. Okay, you can start seeing the color sometimes of. Sometimes you can see the pus collection and it starts projecting it out over the superficial skin layer. And now you can really appreciate the collar stud abscess. Okay. And because of the continuous damaging to the collar abscess skin, what happens is the fifth stage happens to be the sinus formation happens in the later stages. So what are you going to do if there is no sinus, there is no discharge right now seen? So what we can do is we can do an FNAC, a fine needle aspiration cytology, and we can also send the same sample for AFP and culture, which can be a useful investigation for us because in AFP we can confirm the patient is having tuberculosis. In culture we can first identify what is the organism present in that, and we can also start the culture sensitivity for this particular culture swab. No, what we will do, it is reacting to which antibiotic, like that if you start seeing, we can start treating it as a normal abscess. Do you think so? Yes, it can be started with along with the ATT once everything has been confirmed. Okay, what's the differential diagnosis for this cold abscess? Already I have told you it can be a lymph cyst because of any secondaries in the body. It could be a secondary in the neck because of the metastatic effect, or it can be congenital one because of a branchial cyst. Okay, you tell me, what is the treatment for this particular cold abscess? So as I told you, ATT drugs along with a culture sensitivity showing any sensitivity to antibiotics can also be added. Okay, then the non-invasive, I don't want to keep a knife on that particular abscess. What is your next procedure then? It is a zigzag aspiration by wide bore needle in non-dependent area. Okay, therefore, we are planning this kind of a preparation, for example, like zigzag aspiration. Why that is needed? See, we'll be planning in such a way the patient should not have any leak of that particular content of that abscess, so that there is no sinus formation outside over the skin. So we are trying to prevent the sinus formation. For preventing the sinus formation, we are trying as much as possible to just take it without a leakage. Okay, so okay, fine. So this, now we have a too much of pus collection. Okay, we don't have any other choice, we have to drain it. So draining using a non-dependent incision, that is the drain has to be in a non-dependent area. Okay, because the later closure of the wound should be done without placing a drain. Okay, so our first aim is we have to make a non-dependent incision. Okay, then we have to start draining it off. Then we have to close the wound without placing a drain. Okay, because again, if you want to keep a drain, it is going to have a contact or a connect with other people or to his own body. Okay, what are the investigations that you're going to do? Hematocrit. Okay, yes, sir. What is the erythrocyte sedimentation rate, right? So we are going to do a second is erythrocyte sedimentation rate, and then FNAC of the particular lymph node and smear to be sent for AFB and culture. The third investigation is going to be HIV testing, which can be done with the help of ELISA and Western blot. Okay. Next is going to be an open biopsy. Okay. Why are you preparing for an open biopsy if the patient is not good for? You think the patient is not good for FNAC? That's why I'm taking. No. Even after doing FNAC, if you can't come to a conclusion what is the problem with a particular patient, you start opening for an open biopsy. Okay, now the initial wise, as we know, if the patient is having an extra pulmonary tuberculosis, once you have come to an arisal of diagnosis that it could be a tuberculosis, then you should always think of a pulmonary TB, which can be confirmed with the help of Chest X-ray. Always chest X-ray is the best modality of management immediately to see whether the patient is suffering from any pulmonary tuberculosis. Okay. The last but on the least, the sixth point can be a PCR. That is a polymerase chain reaction, which will be very useful method to us. Okay. So now we go to the treatment part. As we know, every time we get a new question on RNTCP, revised tuberculosis protocol, we can usually get in the NEET question. So that should be your point of interest on studying for the NEET. But for this particular extra pulmonary tuberculosis, always we start using the same regimen as we used to know. The drugs that can be started are rifampicin, okay? It is 450 mg once a day in an empty stomach. Okay, it will have a bactericidal effect and it discolors urine into red color. Also, the patient comes to you, usually, you know, I give a rifampicin to the patient. The patient goes home, take the rifampicin. He comes back running to you, sitting there, ma'am, my sweat is also red in color. My urine is red in color, almost like orangish or red in color. And I'm feeling more scared. So this is how patient usually will stop. With this condition, they say, I have taken this medication, I have got blood in my urine, I have got blood in my sweat also. So something is basically wrong with a drug and nothing else. So this is how the patient becomes a default because of rifampicin. So initially, when you start rifampicin, you explain the patient that the urine or the sweat will be orangish or red in color, okay? And then give the patient the rifampicin, okay? And this rifampicin is a hepatotoxic drug, okay? And then isoniazid is a 300 mg OD. It is also bactericidal. It can cause intolerance of GIT. Most usually, isoniazid will cause continuous diarrhea. Patients sometimes rarely will have a nausea and vomiting, that is, which will be continuous. And you can stop it only with the help of an IV emetics, okay? Anti-emetics will be very helpful. Okay, sometimes the patient goes for neuritis and hepatitis. Okay, ethambutol is 800 mg OD, that is once a day, which is bacteriostatic. Okay, this will also cause same kind of like GIT intolerance, retrobulbar neuritis. So what happens in retrobulbar neuritis? The patient gives you an history of, madam, I'm seeing green colored blindness. I'm seeing green color everywhere. So I can't stop the thing. So what happens? The patient starts thinking, he gets affected by this drug and then he stops the drug all of a sudden, and this also a reason for a default. Okay, pyrazinamide 1500 mg OD or 70 mg BD. It is bactericidal, it is hepatotoxic, and it also causes hyperuricemia and also increases the psychosis. Okay, so therefore these all the four drugs is given usually for 6 to 9 months, and then we are going to see how the patient is going to react. If at all, if you want to see the realistic action of the drug happening inside the body, okay, what I do is a collar side abscess which is not ruptured and which has not showed any sinus formation, okay, all these things, okay, start slowly decreasing in stages. You can see without even opening for IND, you can see the size of the collar side abscess coming down because of all the drugs that we are going to give. Okay, so the treatment part, as you already know, we don't want a leakage from that particular site, okay, because it is very contagious. So what we are going to do, there is an aspiration of the cold abscess. Initially, we aspirate with the wide bore needle, okay, always on a non-dependent site along a zigzag track, that is in a zigzag pathway we are going to make, so that we are going to prevent a sinus formation. Okay, so when you're going to poke and take it off, there is no sinus formation at all, so it's a closed one. Okay, so if at all you think it's a long standing closed area infection or an abscess, what you will do, always we have to do an incisional drainage, and if it recurs, then it should be drained again. Okay, so drainage should also be done in a non-dependent incision. After draining, the caseating material, wound is closed without placing a drain. So the most important thing when we do a surgery, for example, an emergency laparotomy, we keep a drain. Okay, we do in any abdomen cases, we keep a drain. Okay, if we are going to open a very big abscess, we are going to keep a drain. Okay, but usually in a collar side abscess, once you do a surgical or a non-invasive procedure, Okay, always we plan that there is no need for a drain to be kept inside the abscess cavity. Okay, so how we are going to do a surgical removal? So my plan is, okay, now I have tried my level best to drain it, okay, but what happens, the abscess is not getting decreased in size, that the drainage is becoming too much serious. What happens, I drain today, again there is a swelling and again there is a new formation of pus, and again I'm going to drain and there is a recurrent drainage of that particular abscess. Okay, so these are the indications where we start thinking of, okay, fine, we have to start a surgical removal of that particular lymph node. So what happens is that surgical removal of our tubercular lymph nodes are indicated when there is no local response to a drug. Okay, we have given rifampicin, isoniazid, and then we have also given pyrazinamide and ethambutol, right? All the four drugs are not reacting to the patient. Okay, that is the first reason you take the patient for surgery. The second is when sinus is going to persist for a long time. Okay, there is a sinus discharge continuously, you can't do anything and you are like stuck with what we have to do. Then you are going to do is like you are going to take for surgical repair. Okay, usually when there is a sinus persisting, okay, it is mainly done with the help of raising a skin flap, removing all the caseating necrosis and material and the lymph nodes also. The care is taken care not to injure a major structure because neck is having a high vascular structures. Okay, so if at all, if you are not going to take a proper care, what can happen? There are carotid artery, external internal jugular veins are there. So these all get starting infected. Okay, so what happened is the next is going to be an excision of the sinus tract, okay, which is an often essential part when the sinus starts developing. So when there is a sinus, okay, there is a pipe which is going to deliver the pus to a particular region. We have to start focusing the sinus tract, start removing it, the full pathway. Okay, we're going to start the removal of full pathway of the sinus, that is called a sinus tract excision. So today's class is very short. I can tell you it's a very important topic. Okay, let's go for a short summary. Okay, so today's topic is tuberculosis lymphadenitis. Always you think of tuberculosis infection is of two types. One can be chest tuberculosis, one can be extrapyramidal tuberculosis. It is a multi-system infection. That's why we are going to divide only into our two major conditions. After that division, we can again divide into the many more conditions, like in extrapulmonary. We can think about the first most common is TB, neck nodes, abdominal tuberculosis, genitourinary TB, skin and soft tissue TB, bones and joint TB, that is arthritis, and osteomyelitis of tibia, or osteomyelitis of the mandible, or also seen, okay? CNS like tuberculosis, meningitis, all these things will come into your mind, okay? So here you can see the chest x-ray of a TB patient, okay? For example, the patient has got a pulmonary TB, a long-standing permanent lung damage is seen. What, as a surgeon, you're going to do? You're going to do a surgical excision. There is a pleural effusion, okay? So in that case, what you're going to do, we're going to do an intercostal drainage. Completely fibrous lung, you're going to go for a pneumonectomy. Okay, extrapyramidal tuberculosis. The first is TB, cervical lymphadenitis. See, I forgot to tell one important neat question. It is also called as scrof lung. Okay, S-C-R-O-F-U-L-A. Okay, it is an important question. Define scrof lung as nothing but a TB, cervical lymphadenitis. Okay. So visually neck nodes are most importantly involved, which can be like jugrodigastric, submandibular, supraclavicular and posterior triangle. Okay. As usual, clinical features will be pyrexia, cough, malaise, and then patient also gives history of loss of weight and loss of appetite. In children, we can always appreciate the failure to thrive. Okay. Cholecystic abscess is the most commonly seen one. Usually the final stage is the sinus part. Okay, so what is the causative organism in this? It is Mycobacterium tuberculosis, which is most common in neck lymph nodes. Okay, and it is also common in upper deep cervical jugulogastric lymph nodes, which is seen in 54% of the cases. Posterior triangle is 22%. Okay, other lymph nodes are also equally affected. Okay, disease may be associated with a HIV infection and lymphomas. Okay, what is the rarest spread? It is through the suprapleural Simpson's fascia or the membrane to the supraclavicular nodes. Okay, if you're going to do a treatment or not a treatment, we can also expect for fibrosis and calcification. The most important question you need as well as in your daily basis, what are the stages of tuberculosis lymphadenitis versus stage of infection and lymphadenitis? Second is going to be a stage of periadenitis and mating. And third stage is going to be stage of caseating necrosis and the cold abscess formation. The fourth is stage of formation of the callosity abscess. And fifth is sinus formation. So what you have done, you have grossly, you're going to see the pathology. It is firm, mater lymph node and cut section will be always showing a yellow caseating necrosis. Microscopically, you can see the epithelial cells with caseating necrosis along with the Langerhans type of a giant cell. Okay, you can also see a chronic granular metastasis most probably in this kind of a scenario. I'm always telling you, cold abscess is a deep to deeper fascia, therefore it is soft, smooth, it is non-tender, it is fluctuant and it does not involve the skin, therefore the fixity of the skin is not seen, therefore skin over the abscess is always pinchable, right? Only if there is a burst of this particular callus, the particular cold abscess, there is a formation of callosity abscess. Therefore, this callosity abscess also on pressure, if it is going to be bursted out, there is a proper discharging sinus and drainage that you can see. Okay, the next is going to be tonsil can may be studded with a tubercle, which is an oral cavity finding. Also check for any permanent tuberculosis signs and also check for a cervical spine tuberculosis. Okay, what is the differential diagnosis for all these cases? It can be lymphadenitis, lymphoma, secondaries, congenital branchial cysts, lymph cysts, and if the patient is having an HIV, it's an immunocompromised state, therefore we can also think of the lymphoid involvement in an HIV patients. Okay, the last part of the list is the fungal infection called as actinomycosis. So I have told you about what is the definition or the scenario in cold abscess, how the patient comes to you, what are the evidences you will see. The evidence is nothing but on deeper to deep fascia, when you start draining it, you can see a cheesy caseating material. Okay. And then there is no signs of any signs of inflammation. Okay. No, it is a not wonky one, not non-tender. It is a smooth, soft, and fluctuant and not transeliminating one. Okay, so FNAC, AFB culture are the usual investigations. Differential diagnosis are bronchial cysts and lymph cysts. So usually treatment will be a ATT drug. So ATT is the most important one. Zigzag aspiration is the second point. Next is going to be the investigation, hematocrit, ESR, AFB, Montux test, HIV test. FNAC for the particular lymph node, AFB can also be helpful for that. And then if the FNAC is not giving you a proper answer of what is the conclusion of that particular swelling, then you go for an open biopsy. Next to that, you go for a chest x-ray where you have to see for any signs of permanent tuberculosis. PCR is the most important method, and the treatment that we're going to do is the drug is ATT drug, which we're going to give for 6 to 9 months. And then if the patient goes for default or MDR-TB, like mildly drug resistant TB, again the categorization differs. But anyway, we are going to treat the patient for the betterment of the patient. So the patient is categorized properly into a category, and then we are going to do the treatment. In the other treatment, aspiration as well as the incision and drainage is done only along the non-dependent area. Okay. And then the closure is done without a drain. That is the most important thing you should have in your mind. Surgical removal always, if you start thinking like surgical removal happens only if there is no local response to the drug. There is a consistent or persistent sinus retainment in the particular area for a long time. We are going to do a rising of skin flux, and then we have to immediately clean the whole area of the caseating material and lymph nodes. Okay. The last point, when there is a sinus discharge, start thinking about the excision of the sinus tract, which is often essential when the sinus is developing. So thank you once again to everyone. So I think the class was really helpful. So we'll see you in some other class with a different topic. Okay. Thank you.